Well, let me tell you about a new sister in the Lord I just met a couple weeks ago while out in Ogden, Utah. Her name is Joan. Joan, growing up in her life, she grew up in a Catholic home. And unfortunately, along the way, one of the priests began to really hound the family and the church about money in a, sounds like a pretty unholy way. And it turned off her dad, turned off her family, and they stopped going. And it really formed into a pretty negative distaste of Christianity as a whole for her. And so she grows up, and she wants nothing to do with Christianity, but she's definitely seeking after spiritual things. And so she got into all sorts of stuff, but she eventually became a Wiccan. Well, she was following into that, and she, again, could not stand Christianity. In fact, she said that she would, when there would be a Christian bookstore, she would walk on the other side of the street. She had wanted nothing to do with Christianity. Well, but she's seeking, and of course, Wiccan and everything else out there is never going to fulfill the hole in your heart. It's never going to satisfy you. And so she's feeling that. And one day she's going by and she sees a sign on the side of the road that says CMA Rally. And something, of course, we now know it's the Holy Spirit, something was stirring her heart to go. She had no idea what CMA meant. And so she shows up, and there's all these bikers. And the CMA is Christian Motorcycle Association. And if you meet Joan, she is not the typical biker, you know. And so she shows up. She's thinking, what am I doing? But the Holy Spirit was moving on her in this way. Long story short, this one of the women, a Christian woman there, approaches her, initiates conversation with her, begins to then meet with her multiple times. And Joan admits, she's like, yeah, we really challenged her a lot. And I had this, challenge and this one. And this Christian woman just continued to give her grace and truth together. And finally, over time, Joan finally realized that the Lord really does love her. And she was saved. Now, what if this Christian woman didn't even initiate the conversation that day? Or what if this Christian woman, maybe she did that, but as the first time that Joan challenged her, she got afraid and cut it off and stopped and didn't do it anymore. Joan wouldn't know the Lord, at least in that, from her, you see? See, God, here's the big idea today. If we love Jesus, then we're going to share the gospel accurately, boldly, compassionately, verbally, and passionately. We're gonna share the gospel in these five different ways. And so we're gonna actually go through a lot of scripture today. This is more than normal if you're visiting with us. We're gonna go through chapter 3 of Acts and then chapter 4 all the way up to verse 12. When we do this, I want to give you a heads up. It's a little bit like last week too. Not that I planned it this way, it just happened to go that way. But there's 5 points of that. And the first one we're going to spend the most time on today. And then it kind of like picks up speed as we kind of going down a hill, okay? So for those that are pacing and you're looking at your outline and you're thinking this is going to be a really long sermon, it's not going to be as long as you think it is, okay? But the first point, because there's so much in these scriptures, is this, is that we need to share the gospel accurately. All right. So share the gospel accurately. I'm going to teach a little bit about what does that mean. But let me paraphrase Acts chapter 3 verses, the first so many verses, 1 through 11 at least. And then we'll go verse by verse after this. Here's what's happening. Peter and John, maybe you've heard of these guys. These are apostles, 12 apostles of Jesus. And so they're in Jerusalem and they're going during an hour of prayer at the Jerusalem temple. They're praying. Well, as they're going, there's this man who was born lame. And he's begging, and he goes to them, he begs them for money. And Peter and John turn to him, and Peter says, hey, we can't give you money. We don't have any, basically, but we'll pray over you. And so they prayed in the name of Jesus over this man, and he was miraculously healed. And this guy, again, was born that way, so he's been there for many, many years. And naturally, a crowd forms. They're thinking, this is crazy. This guy's jumping around. And before, he was always laying there every day, day in and day out. And so a crowd forms. And Peter and John, they were so afraid, they went home. No, just kidding. What do? They say, hey, this is an opportunity to share the good news of Jesus Christ. And so that's what we see happening in the temple there, the courts, is an evangelistic sermon that we're gonna listen in on, and we're gonna learn some of these aspects of how to give the gospel by how they did it. And as I've said, the first one is to share it accurately. So what do I mean by that? Well, let's dive into verse 12, okay? And here we go. And when Peter saw it, the crowd, okay, he addressed the people. Men of Israel, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we have made him walk, the lame man? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered over and denied in the presence of Pilate. Now, let me just pause there. I don't know if you caught that, but hey, you guys delivered him and over to Pilate, you denied him. That's interesting. We're going to come to that. Okay, let's move on. When he had decided to release him, but you denied the holy and righteous one and asked for a murderer to be granted to you. So there it is again, right? You denied Jesus. And in fact, you also exchanged a murderer for him, all right? So they're pointing that out, and they don't stop there. Look at verse 15. And you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. Just by the way, a little side note. When people tell you that Jesus never claimed, or the Bible never claims that Jesus was God, they're talking about Jesus here as the author of life. That's God. It's right there again. But here's the point. They're telling them, hey, you killed God. That's what they're telling the crowd. Now, does this sound politically correct to you? Does this sound, don't throw anything at me, like friendship evangelism to you? Does this sound like a lot of the ways that pastors and Christians are teaching us of how to share the gospel these days? Sounds a little different, doesn't it? Let's read on. Chapter 3, verse 16. And his name, by faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know, and the faith that is through Jesus has given the man his perfect health in the presence of you all. And now, brothers, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. Now we're getting a little bit of compassion from Peter and John now. They're saying, hey, okay, you guys did all this stuff. They're not gonna sugarcoat the fact that they denied, rejected, and exchanged the God in the flesh, the Holy and righteous one, for a murderer, but we do know that you guys didn't really know what you were doing. That's what ignorance means, okay? Now, is he saying, though, that they're off the hook then? Are they off the hook? Well, look at verse 18. But what God foretold by the mouth of all the prophets that his Christ would suffer, he thus fulfilled. Look at verse 19. Repent, therefore, and turn back, that your sins may be blotted out. So does it sound like the crowd is off the hook? No. Instead, they point out, you've sinned. They use that word and they say, repent, which means to turn around. You see, because when we sin, even ignorantly, it is still, at the end of the day, falling short of the mark of perfection that we need in order to get to heaven. It still needs dealt with. It still needs blotted out. It still needs erased, our sin. And the only way to do that, as they're saying, as they're rightfully telling this crowd, is repent, which is we're all born going towards our sin and away from God. And it's a 180 degree turn where we say, Jesus, I can't be good enough. I need you. I'm sorry for my sins. And that's how you get forgiveness. And that's what we hear in the baptism testimonies of people who have done that in their life. And so they call people to repent, this crowd to repent, even when they ignorantly sinned against the Lord. Now remember, we're trying to learn out of this how we are called to share the gospel with other people. And so far up to this point, we've learned that we need to share it accurately with some facts. When we're talking to someone, we need to include some of these things. One, we need to include the bad news of sin. All right? And I know that we just talked about that last week, but as I was looking at this passage, it just comes out in the scriptures constantly, the bad news of sin, that we need to make sure that people understand and they own, because the only way to really repent is to own that you were going the wrong way. And so we need to inform people of the truth that we're all born sinners, rebellious against God, that one sin makes us guilty of all of them, and that we can't have any sin in us if we're going to get to heaven. People need to own that. And so we need to talk about the bad news of sin. Secondly, then, we need to call people to repent, to turn from it, to own the sin and say, I'm sorry, and to ask for forgiveness and those kinds of things. So now we're going to go the rest of chapter 3 into chapter 4, verse 12, all the way through chapter 12. So it's going to be a lot of scripture. But we're also going to learn this. Another part of accurately giving the gospel is that we also then obviously want to give the good news. Okay? Let me say this. For churches like Westboro, for example, here's the problem. There's a lot of problems with them. But one of the big problems is they never give the good news. They just beat people up, you know? And some of the things, I'm gonna clarify, some of the things they say are true, but they never give the good news, all right? So we gotta make sure we give the good news as well. And there's three things specifically about the good news of who Jesus is and what he did for us that if you can remember these three, these are important and good. One is Jesus lived a perfect life. One, two, that Jesus died on the cross for our sins. And three, he rose from the dead, the resurrection. Those three things are important. Now, the first one, Jesus lived a perfect life, has actually already been told that we've already read. It's in verse 14, what we just read. It says, but you denied the holy and righteous one. Holy and righteous means perfect, set apart and perfect. Jesus lived a perfect life. The why that's important is because the only way that we can get to heaven is someone who was perfect, lived a perfect life, would pay the price for us, you see? So maybe you've heard someone say, well, I think Jesus was close to perfect, but I'm sure he did some small sins and things like that. You don't want that. We are doomed to hell if Jesus made any sin, even one. It is, and the scriptures say right there, he was holy and righteous. He was perfect, never sinned. And it's important for your salvation and mine because we needed a perfect sacrifice for us. Does it make sense? Okay, so we've already seen that. That's already been brought out in their gospel presentation. Now, the other two facts of Jesus' life, they're gonna come out of the rest of chapter 3 and verse 4. And I wanna just say this is a lot of scripture, okay? And so if you start seeing your neighbor, check out. You just hit them. It's a holy purpose, okay? Just hit them. All right, here we go. You ready? Hang with me. And this is gonna be a lot more helpful if you're following in your own Bible. Chapter 3, verse 20. All right, now, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send the Christ appointed for you, Jesus. Pause. You see, here they're giving the good news. Right? I mean, they've given the bad news, but now they're giving the good news that Jesus has come and that Jesus is willing to come into your heart is what he's saying through the Holy Spirit after we repent. So here's the good news. Now, verse 21, talking about Jesus, whom heaven must receive until the time for restoring all the things above which God spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets long ago. Moses said, the Lord God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brothers. And you shall listen to him in whatever he tells you. And it shall be that every soul who does not listen to that prophet shall be destroyed from the temple. Really quick, a little bit more bad news reminder there. You know, they'll be destroyed if you reject, right? It just keeps coming in and out. Verse 24, and all the prophets who have spoken from Samuel and those who came after him also proclaim these days. You are the sons of the prophets and of the covenant that God made with your fathers, saying to Abraham, and now he quotes Old Testament, and in your offspring shall all the families of the earth be blessed. There's good news that all the peoples of the world, we can be blessed because of a descendant of Abraham who ended up being Jesus. That's good news. Verse 26, and God, here's an important point, having raised up his servant, that's Jesus, that's talking about Jesus's resurrection, sent him to you first to bless you by turning every one of you from your wickedness. Okay. And so we're seeing the bad news brought out a little bit more. We're seeing the good news be brought out a little bit more. And now we're going to, and that was the sermon and that they give. And now as we go into chapter 4, now we're going to see a dialogue between the religious leaders and the apostles, and more of the accurate gospel is going to come out, and I'm going to try to highlight it as we go. But if you're with me, hang with me here. And if you're not, hope your neighbor hits you. And let's go, verses 1 through 12, and then I promise we'll get out of the scripture and get back into applying a little bit more and understanding it. Verse 1 of chapter 4, and as they were speaking to the people, the priest and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them. Ooh, here comes religious leaders. Okay. Greatly annoyed because they were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. You see the resurrection again? You see how the themes just keep coming out? I'm trying to highlight those so that we can see these, the perfect life of Jesus, holy and hope, righteous one, right? And then the death of Jesus, and then the resurrection of Jesus, and so it keeps coming out. Verse 3, and so they arrested them and put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. But many of those who had heard the word believed, and the number of the men came to about 5,000. And on the next day, their rulers and elders and scribes gathered together in Jerusalem with Annas the high priest and Caiaphas and John and Alexander and all who were of the high priestly family. Verse 7, and when they had set them in the midst, they inquired, by what power or by what name did you do this? And then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, oh, I always love it when the scriptures say that, something good's about to happen, said to them, rulers of the people and elders, if we are being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, by what means this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, bad news again, just little note, whom God raised from the dead, good news, resurrection, you see that? By him, this man is standing before you well. And this Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you. Bad news again. There it is. The builders, which has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Do you guys hear the accurate gospel just coming through and through in both the sermon and then the dialogue with the religious leaders? You see, guys, when we share the gospel, give the bad news, give the call to repentance, give the good news of what Jesus did specifically. He lived a perfect life that we could not live. He died the death that we deserve on the cross, and he rose from the dead and conquered all those powers that were against us. And those are things that we should try to focus in on and memorize these kinds of things. Now, what's interesting too in verse 2 of chapter 4 with the religious leaders is actually the resurrection that annoyed them. It was the resurrection that annoyed them. And one of the reasons why is because so they had these, the Sadducees were there. And you're like, well, what's up with the Sadducees? See, the Sadducees were the contemporary liberal theologians of Jesus' day. They were ones that didn't believe in a number of things, for instance, resurrections, period. And so when they're talking about Jesus being raised from the dead and all this kind of stuff, it bothered them and they couldn't stand it. Now, I want to remind us of this, though. The Sadducees bore the name of Yahweh. They were Jewish leaders. They were in the church. So the equivalent of people like that today would be pastors and seminary professors within the walls and the life of Christianity that might have a cross and call themselves a Christian. But even then, if they're liberal, they're wrong. And here's the thing, the accurate gospel exposes them. The accurate gospel will expose them. I'm gonna put it this way. The true gospel is like a knife with a serrated edge that cuts one's soul. But it also cuts between the true and false Christians, and it also cuts between true and false churches even. That's right. You see, that's why it's important that we know the accurate gospel. And so let's go now one more time in the dialogue of Peter and John, and we're gonna see one more detail of the accurate gospel that comes out that we wanna also include as we're talking to people. And verse 12, it's an amazing verse. Love this verse. And there is salvation. You guys with me there looking at that? And there is salvation in anyone who is at least sincere, even if it's not within Christianity. You guys, that's not what your Bible said? That's odd. Okay, let me try it again. And there is salvation in anyone in any religion, even if it's not Christianity. No? Okay, let me try one more time. I'm sure I'll get this. And there's salvation in anyone if they're at least a good person, even if they don't know Jesus, if they're a good person. No? All right, I'll stop playing. Here's the real verse. And there is salvation in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Church, Harvest, what's the name? Jesus. Amen to that, right? Jesus. I just love the name of Jesus. I love the name of Jesus. I love, there's a song about that. Oh, the beautiful name of Jesus. And we just talked, sang about it. This is a new song. There's an old song too. I don't even know what it is. But Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I love it. I love him because it's more than just a name, but it encompasses him. He is everything. And so when we share the gospel, we also want to include the exclusivity of Jesus. I know that's a big word, but what it means is it's only Jesus that we can receive eternal life. And don't let anybody fool you. They might say, well, that's not really what Jesus meant, or, you know, all these. I mean, it's so clear in the New Testament that only Jesus, which means universalism will not happen. There are no other doors. There's no other back door. And Jesus, in fact, Jesus gave a parable about that idea. If that doesn't work, there's not enough good works we can do. There's no other religion that will work. There's no other false Jesus is going to happen. Only the real Jesus of the Holy Scriptures can save us. I might. I'm getting into it, brother. Love it. Because he changes your life. He changes your life and everything, everything. Think about this. People's eternal future rests on the real Jesus or not. Mm-hmm. And so it's important for us. I encourage us. I hope you've been taking notes about these things. That we need to know some of these important parts of what the real gospel of Jesus is. And when we share them, don't worry. I mean, if you have to have a little, maybe a note with these things on it, and it's in your wallet, in your purse or whatever, and you got to pull it out, okay, it's okay. It's okay. But let's give the real gospel and the real Jesus who can really save people. Amen? Amen. All right. Well, let's now look there. So we want to give it accurately. Well, what else about sharing the gospel? We're going to look again in chapter 4 now. The rest of it, we're going to go verses 13 through 20, and then we're going to give some other points here. Here we go. Now, when they, the religious leaders, they saw the boldness of Peter and John. You might want to circle boldness. We're going to come back to that. They saw the boldness of Peter and John, and they perceived that they were uneducated and common men. They were astonished. And they recognized they had been with Jesus. But seeing the man who was healed standing beside them, they had nothing to say in opposition. But when they had commanded them to leave the council, they conferred with one another, saying, "What shall we do with these men? For that a notable sign has been performed through them is evident to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it. But in order that it may spread no further among the people, let us warn them not to speak no more to anyone in this name." And so they called them and charged them to not speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John answered them, "Whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you rather than to God, you must judge. For we cannot but speak of what we have seen and heard." When we share the gospel, we need to share it accurately. We also need to be willing to share it boldly, to share it boldly. And what we see in chapter 4 here with this religious posse that shows up, and they arrest Peter and John. They arrest them, why? Because they've given the accurate, serrated, edged gospel, and it's ticking them off, and they don't want it, and so they arrest them. Now, I don't know about you, but I haven't been arrested yet, for sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. And if you have, I'd love to know about it. Tell me about it. I'd like to know that. And I got friends in legal places that might be able to figure that out. Thankfully, still in our country, we are free, right? We are free to do that. But I will say, I have actually had, on the other hand, some people threaten legal action against me, but that's another story for another time. All right, verse 18, the Christians now, these disciples, now, they're also not just arrested, but then they're told in verse 18 to stop sharing the gospel, right? Now, maybe we haven't been arrested, but maybe some here, you've been told by somebody, maybe a family member, a friend, a coworker, stop sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. I've actually had that happen one time. I was on a plane, and I was sharing the gospel with someone next to me. I had a great conversation with them, and they enjoyed it, and I enjoyed it, whatever. And then I got done, but on the other side of me, I didn't know, but there was an old, and she told me later, she was an old Jewish woman, and she was listening in on the whole thing. Well, I got done, and she was visibly not happy about it, what she heard. So she leaned over to me, and she said, I don't get you Christians. I don't like the fact that, why can't you just stay to yourselves? I mean, who, in so many words, she said, like, who gives you the right to talk to other people and try to change their mind? Let's just, you know, coexist, you know, that kind of thing. And so I happened to be sitting in the exit aisle with the door. So I just opened the door and I pushed her out, and I confessed to the Lord later, and he's forgiven me. No, actually we were landed by that point. But anyway, but no, what I told her was, what I told her with love and compassion, I said, you know, here's the thing. I know you don't understand this, but Jesus told us to do this. And I love people. I love you. I love others. And I pray that someday, I told her this. I said, I'm going to be praying for you. I said, I'm going to be praying that God will show you someday. And even if we never see each other again, but someday you'll be thankful because your eyes will be open that Jesus is the Messiah. And he came to live and die and raise from the dead for you. And that you would give your life to him. And that you would then someday understand why I was doing what I was doing. Here's the thing. We're going to face persecution when we give the gospel. It's just how it goes. And Jesus promised that if they persecuted me, they're going to persecute you also. And that's why we need to have boldness. Christianity is not for wimps. Christianity is a hard thing. And we need boldness, and we cannot be afraid. We got to be willing to be unafraid witnesses. Because when you look at Peter and John, they weren't afraid. But I always want to remind you too, Peter, not too long before this, he was afraid and he denied Jesus, ever even knowing Jesus three times. And so I'm going to encourage you, the Holy Spirit has come to give you power. And if you ask him, he'll give you boldness for him. And in fact, if you caught it there, I had you circle it, but in verse 4, it says, Yeah, it talks about the boldness that they had, isn't it? But also in verse 4, what I love about this too, think about the boldness. Because the disciples were willing to be bold, look at the fruit that came from it. Many of those who had heard the word believed. And the number of the men came to about 5,000, which you can do a little study with the act and with the book of Acts and the growth. But basically, it could be that up to 1,500 people came to know Jesus Christ because of this event. 1,500 people. Here's the thing. There are potentially up to 1,500 people that are thankful that Peter and John did not give in to fear, but instead they put their lives on the line to give the good news of Jesus in boldness. Amen? Amen. Now, another thing is the person on the plane, the Jewish woman, as well as this religious leaders, they ask an interesting question in verse 7. They say, now, by what power or name are you saying this? In other words, like the woman on the plane said to me, who gives you the right? Who gives you the right to be sharing and engaging and initiating spiritual conversations with other people? Who gives you the right to do that? And see, the disciples, they answered between verses 8 through 12, the name of Jesus. Jesus is the one who's given me the right. And that plays into the Great Commission in Matthew 28, verse 20, 18 through 20. He says, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me, therefore go. He has all the authority, because here's the thing, he's the king of every human being. Do you know that? Your unbelieving friends and neighbors and coworkers, did you know that Jesus is actually their king? They just are not kneeling to him yet. And the scriptures say in the end of life, in the great judgment, every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, Master, King. You see, what we're trying to do with the good news of the gospel is we're trying to help people to choose him now and bend the knee now and become a obedient submissive servant to him instead of a rebellious one and then get the wrath of God later, you see. And so, it's that authority. We have the authority. The woman on the plane, yes, I know you don't get this. I know you might not even agree with this, but at the end of the day, Jesus is your king, and he's given me the authority to do this. That's how I have the right to do this. And the disciples are saying that to religious leaders. Jesus is the one who's given us the authority. And their boldness shocked these guys. So we need to give it boldly. Let me ask you, are you bold for Jesus Christ? Do you grasp the fact that Jesus has given you the authority to start spiritual conversations with people around you? Or have you believed maybe some of the lies around, even within the church, that you gotta wait for people? You gotta, okay? I wanna be careful, there's clarifications and things, but when I hear people say you have to earn someone's trust, I hear what you're saying, but honestly, it does not fit in through the scriptures. Because you can sit there and look at a lot of different sermons throughout the book of Acts, and they didn't know these people from Adam. And they're giving them the bad news, they're calling them to repent, they're mentioning the word sin, and they're giving them the good news of Jesus Christ. They didn't earn any trust. I'm just saying, because we have to understand, we have the authority from the King to give the good news. Now, if we're talking about grace and compassion, we're gonna get to that, okay? Which we're hearing. But do not think that you can't give the gospel to a stranger. There are many people who have come to know Jesus Christ because a stranger shared the gospel with them. And maybe some of you in this room, you're listening to me right now because you came to know the Lord because a stranger shared the gospel with you. All right, so boldness. Have it, pray for it, the Spirit will give it to you. Now there's three more, and like I said, they go quicker as we go through. All right, the third thing is compassionately. Share the good news of Jesus with boldness, right? Accurately, but also compassionately. Because do you notice what started this whole ordeal, this whole event, and all that was coming from it back in chapter 3 is that the disciples simply loved a man who was born lame. And they just simply prayed in the name of Jesus that he would be healed. Of course, God chose to heal him. God doesn't always heal, but he chose to heal that man. And that's what created this whole thing. But it was a simple, unadulterated, no strings attached act of love. That's what these guys did. They weren't going out trying to just stir things just to stir things. They were acting in love and compassion to someone. But then they did open their mouths and they were giving the gospel, right, accurately, and it created some issues. But the point is this, is that they were being compassionate. And compassion, acts of love are very important for us when we're out there loving on our neighbors and our friends and our family. Now, we might not have as many visible miracles today. They're still happening, trust me, they are happening. But we may not have that kind of thing happen. But in the same way, when we give a meal to someone, or when we shovel their driveway or put salt on it when the ice comes tonight, and when we do that, those kinds of things for people, in a sense, it's shining Jesus through those acts of love. It's evidence that he's alive and he's powerful and he's real through our lives. And those are acts of compassion that we can do and we should do. In fact, a familiar passage a lot of us know in 1 Peter 3:15-16, right? It says, but in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to give a defense to anyone who asks you for the reason for the hope that is in you. And here's the key, yet do it with gentleness and respect. You hear that? The compassion, gentleness and respect, because then what happens? Having a good conscience so that when, not if, but when you are slandered, there's the persecution again that's been promised. Those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. In other words, they're not gonna have any grounds. Kind of like these religious leaders, they were kind of like shut. They were like, oh, we're happy, we're not happy, we're mad. But then they did this compassionate thing and it's kind of like, it's making it hard for them to really persecute. And that's what we as a church are trying to do is Harvest. You see, you may not know this, but our church in the last 3.5 years, because we are ferociously dedicated to the real, accurate, full gospel of Jesus Christ, amen, we've shaken the church world a little bit around us and we've shaken the communities around us a little bit. And we've got some people out there that when they think of our church, it's not all positive. And we understand that because that comes with the territory of holding to the accurate gospel. But on the other hand, that's why also, because we care about people, we are constantly trying to show love in other forms as well. We carried out the big Fusion Fest Community Festival for free last summer. We did a VBS for free for people to come. We've taken food and coffee, breakfast, and things to all the faculty and staff of all the schools in our area. I've gone and prayed with city officials. I mean, we're constantly, I'm just scraping the surface of the things that we do of compassion that also need to come with the truth. I'll put it this way. We need to make it hard for people not to like you with acts of love while not compromising the truth that can set them free. I'm going to say that again. We want to make it hard for people not to like you with acts of love while not compromising the truth that can set them free. So I'm going to give you a little bit of illustration. It's like a teeter-totter, all right? On one half is grace or love, acts of compassion. The other one is the truth of the serrated, with the serrated edge of the gospel, the accurate gospel. And we are trying to be like this with every person around. As individual Christians, we're trying to be like this as a church, right? We're not going to give up one for the other. We're not going to get unhealthy on one or the other. We want to have both. And Jesus, he's our perfect model of that. He came in grace and truth perfectly. And that's what we want to strive for. But I want to make this really clear. As we strive to have compassion and boldness and the accurate gospel, that even if you nail it and you get an A on that, you still are going to have people persecute you. Because Jesus got killed, and he was the perfect one who could do it. Almost all the apostles got persecuted. They all got persecuted, and most of them got killed. And the early church got killed, you know, persecuted and killed. And so it's going to come with the territory, but this is our responsibility. Compassion and the accurate gospel of truth, right? So that's what we're aiming for. Now, two more really quickly. Share the gospel also verbally. Verbally. Notice again in Acts 4, verses 15 through 17, the religious leaders, they try to stop the disciples from what exactly? Speaking the name of Jesus. Speaking the name of Jesus. You see, it's words that offend. It's words. Simply opening our mouths with the accurate gospel of Jesus, it'll offend those who are spiritually proud. And so we've all heard this quote, and I'm going to do my best to be nice with it. Or at least precursor it this way. It's not in the Bible. How about that? Okay. But it's got some good meaning to it. But it's unbalanced the way that I hear most people use it. Share the gospel, and if or when necessary, what? Use words. That's not in the Bible, just so y'all know. And even those that attribute it to Francis Assisi, that's even debatable. But anyway, but here's the thing. When we say share the gospel and if when necessary, use words, like we don't understand theologically, that makes no sense at the end of the day. We hear what they're trying to say, right? It's not all just truth, 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 no compassion with it at all. Like that's unhealthy. That's not good. Okay. That's what we're trying to do. But it's a pendulum shift too far the other way because if that's how sharing the gospel is, that it's basically just actions and not words, nobody will get saved. Okay. In fact, when you look at the disciples, the reason that the religious leaders are upset with them and they tell them to stop speaking is because they were always speaking. They kept opening their mouths, right? They don't tell them to stop healing people. They tell them to stop speaking because they always spoke. That's why. This was what they did. And because, for instance, here's the little theology. Romans 10:14 says that someone cannot be saved unless they hear the gospel of Jesus Christ and respond accurately. If we are not speaking, they don't hear. Does that make sense? So it has to be given. And this fits into, and Peter and John in verses 18 through 20, ending in 20, that's why they said themselves, they said, we cannot but speak of what we have seen and heard. You see, the speaking and the verbal just keeps coming out through all of this. And when you study the life of Jesus, let me summarize Jesus' life in 1 minute. Okay, here we go. Miracles, compassion, acts of love, heal, feed a bunch of people, all this kind of stuff, right? And then open his mouth and the crowds start going away and people are mad and people are trying to kill him. Okay, and then here's miracles, acts of love, compassion, and it's always sincere and genuine. And the crowd's back, and then he opens his mouth again. Like if for those that are like business growth consultants, if they met with Jesus, they'd be like, all right, Jesus, your miracles are awesome. You keep those up, but stop opening your mouth, basically. Because every time you open your mouth, you're ruining it. But here's the thing that Jesus knew that we need to know. He knew that those miracles would not save anybody. In fact, they were just signs to get people to be willing to listen to the truth. That's what they were for. And to verify, obviously, who he is and all that kind of stuff. But the thing is that he knew that the gospel verbally had to be said for people to be saved. There's not one person listening to my voice right now that you are saved today because of an act of love. You are saved today because someone spoke the gospel to you. Now, again, acts of love need to come with the verbal presentation of the gospel. Right? But it's the verbal presentation of the gospel that saved you. And that's what people need to have. Amen? Amen. Do not be afraid to open your mouth, but also again, know that it's also the same very thing that will offend those who are proud, but we cannot control that. That's not our responsibility. Finally, here it is. Share the gospel of Jesus passionately. I hope you've heard some passion come through today, even as I've been talking about all of this. But we need to be passionate when we give the gospel to people. And look at verse 20 again. What was their response when they're told to stop giving the gospel? They said, but we cannot but speak of what we have seen and heard. They had this passion, didn't they? They had to share the good news of Jesus Christ. They had to share how Jesus had changed their lives and was changing other people's lives. Nobody was going to stop them. Even with the threat of arrest again, and worse, they just had to, there was passion. And that fits into what also Paul said himself later on in 1 Corinthians 9:16. He says, for if I preach the gospel, that gives me no grounding for boasting, but here it is, for necessity is laid on me, woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. You guys hear the fire in the bones of these guys? They had passion. This is so convicting. Do we feel like that about giving the gospel to people? Do we feel like we have to share this good news with other people? Is it eating at our souls that we're not sharing the good news with other people? It's so convicting to me. And I encourage you, here's the thing. If you're like, you know what? I'll just be honest with you. I don't have a lot of passion for it. Here's how you can change that. Every day, ask the Lord, Lord, would you give me passion? Give me passion for the good news. Give me passion to share it with those that I love around me. And he'll do that. You know, I was thinking through the life of our church. There's at least easily over 20 different people, young and old, that have given their life to Jesus Christ since our church was founded. And you know what? They came to our church and they heard an accurate gospel presentation and God did a miracle in their life. I also know that there's probably many, many more that have also come here and they've walked away upset and mad because of the serrated edge of the gospel of Jesus Christ. But I can tell you this, these 20-some people are thankful that this church was willing to share the gospel accurately, boldly, compassionately, verbally, and passionately. And we have 20-some more brothers and sisters in the Lord among, in our midst because this is the stuff that we've been striving for, because here's the thing. There are greater things to come. And there are greater things still to be done in this city, in this metro, for the glory of Jesus Christ. And so let's stand and let's worship the one who has saved us.